Hey, what is up guys? It's Dr. Sammy, and in today's video, I'm gonna share some tips on how to do surgical extractions more efficiently. A lot of you guys have been asking me about what advanced courses I take to do surgical extractions in my practice. And unfortunately, there aren't a lot out there, and mainly it comes down to skill and expertise and a little bit of time. But fortunately for us, I have a colleague that runs an online extraction course based in Canada, and he has a series of videos that makes it easier for people to learn about extractions if you haven't had the proper training before. In this video, I'm gonna share his tips on sectioning teeth and his tips on troughing bone. I hope you learned something that you may have not known before. Enjoy.
Occasionally, when we're sectioning teeth and splitting them with an elevator, the crack doesn't always propagate in the direction that we want it to. Now, that's usually our fault because we've sectioned it maybe incorrectly or we've applied the wrong type of force to get that good split, but it will happen and you need to be able to deal with it if it does happen. When you are sectioning teeth, so let's say you're doing an upper molar, you're going to section this tooth. Typically, you're going to cut that Y-shaped pattern into there. Now, that's going to leave you with three pieces of tooth. That is terrific, assuming you have three individual roots. Now, you won't always have that. So if you start every time by sectioning off the crown of the tooth, and what I will typically do is take everything above the height of contour. So anything that's useless to our forceps or our elevator, that goes initially. And what that's usually going to do is it's going to open everything up into that pulp chamber so that you can now see some of the root structure. So you may see in there a C-shaped root canal. Now that would indicate that you may have fusion of two roots and not indeed three separate roots like you thought you did when you first looked at the PA. Now that's going to save you because you can now section that tooth a little bit differently than you may have planned. So let's say that the distal and palatal root is fused. You may just section down around the mesial root to get that one disconnected from the rest of it and get it out of the way. So if you wouldn't look at that initially, you're going to cut through here, you're going to section down partway through that distal and palatal root, you're going to cut deeper and deeper thinking you're trying to get through the furcation, and really you're just obliterating that root and weakening it to make your job more difficult down the road. Now on a lower molar, same thing here. If you cut this crown off, basically what you're allowing yourself to do is get a better visualization of the root surface. And because these roots are offset from the occlusal surface, when you get rid of the occlusal surface, now you're more likely to section these in an appropriate manner without tipping that burr at the wrong axis to cut through one of these roots. Be shy to sink your burr way down in there. Now make sure that you're always clear of critical anatomy, the sinus and the IAN, but if you're nowhere near that or you can't get near that with your burr, make sure that you go very deeply to the point where you can see bleeding that's originating from the middle of your section. So give it a good rinse in there with some saline as you've sectioned. Make sure that you're completely through the tooth so that you don't have to rely on your elevator to split it the rest of the way. Now the exception to this may be on the mandible. You don't want to section completely through to the lingual, so make sure that you section almost all the way, about two-thirds of the way. And then the tip there would be ensure that the crown again is off. Seat this as deeply as you can. Seat your elevator as deeply as you can in your split, and you want to rotate it gently towards one of those sides. And what's going to happen is you're going to split that tooth. If you rotate too high up, or you leave the crown intact and you try to split that tooth, now your forces are generating along a different plane and you're going to get a propagating crack that goes in the wrong direction. If you're dealing with a lower molar, what I could tell you is, or even an upper molar, you can section these teeth erring on the side of a distal angulation. So what I mean by that is if you section down in here and you maybe think that you're angling that burr, but you're getting down into that mesial root instead of tipping things back through the furcation, you're going to cut this mesial portion, weaken it, and you're going to have a fractured off root tip that you're going to have to retrieve. Now, I would much rather be sectioning this way, weakening the distal part, and delivering now the mesial in one chunk and having to take out the distal root. The reason for that is that your visualization when the patient is laying there is way better when you've got a distal root than if you've got a mesial root. So always err to the distal if you're not quite sure. So your PA, you can tell that those roots are really leaning. You think that you're leaning distally. Always go maybe a little bit farther than you expect to do. Now, same thing on the upper. It's a little bit easier to work on the distal portions of these teeth. So Again, what you want to do is you want to be airing to the side of the distal if you are trying to locate that furcation and trying to split that tooth, say between these buccal roots. So way easier to get a tooth out if you can see it versus one that's butted up against the adjacent teeth in an area that's difficult to access. Anytime that you pick up a handpiece with the intention of removing bone around a tooth, you need to have a plan in place, and you need to understand why you're about to remove the bone that you're going to remove, and you need to be very deliberate in terms of your execution of the plan that you create. Now, removing bone should allow you to either make the extraction faster or easier, one of the two. So don't just pick up a handpiece and start blasting bone away and think that you just need to take away as much as you can to free up that tooth so that you can get it out. Anytime that you're looking at removing bone versus maybe sacrificing tooth, you should probably err on the side of sectioning the tooth or cutting the tooth versus taking away more bone. Now, we want to be conservative somewhat back here is what I'm trying to get at, in that we don't want to weaken the mandible too much. So the mandible is a functional bone that it's under a lot of heavy stresses. Once you take the third molar out, you've opened up a line of weakness in the mandible, and if you take more bone away in addition to that tooth, now that's even weaker, and you could subject your patient to a possible postoperative fracture or even a fracture as you're doing the procedure. So be conservative, but be deliberate. Now, when we're doing our bone removal back there, we also want to keep some cortical bone. So our trough should be going down alongside the tooth, but we want to try to preserve some of this cortical bony collar. Now, why do we do that? Well, we want to have something that's very solid to place an elevator on to fulcrum off of. So if you take a lot of the cortical bone away and you drop it way down kind of beneath where you want to have your purchase point, you're going to have much less of a levering action and less ability to lift those teeth out. So try to conserve some for that reason as well. The other thing that we want to conserve bone for, and I don't know if we can see it so well on here, but we want to try to keep a bony collar in behind this lower second molar. So there'll be some bone here, cortical bone, that comes in behind the second molar that's very important for healing. So you always try to preserve that bit of bone if you can when you're doing your trough or your bone removal. Also, when you're trying to do that, that's going to prevent you from hopefully damaging this tooth, which is a possibility when you're running a high-speed drill in the back of the mouth where access and visibility is sometimes a little bit poorer. Now, when we actually make this trough, the depth that we want to get to is typically to the CEJ of the tooth. Now, the amount of bone removal, of course, will be dictated by the type of impaction, the angulation and orientation of the tooth once you've exposed it. But generally, you want to take your bone removal down to the CEJ or maybe just slightly beyond. So what you're trying to do is get past the height of contour on the tooth and get somewhere where you can then place a purchase point or get your elevator down deeper on the tooth to gain a mechanical advantage to help to elevate that tooth out. So you're basically trying to get rid of any bony interferences in the path of withdrawal for that tooth to allow you then to use gentler forces when you're elevating on the tooth, which then will result in fewer complications. Now, the other goal of bone removal down here is basically to get the bone off of the tooth so that you can orient yourself to how that impaction is sitting, because sectioning is going to be the next step. And in order to section this tooth successfully, you need to know exactly where you're oriented and where, say, the buccal groove is, for example, so that you can start to split that tooth perfectly in half. So how do we go about selecting the appropriate handpiece to trough around third molars and section these teeth? Well, first off, we need to find a handpiece that is very efficient at cutting and very safe when we're working back in this region of the mouth. Now that limits us to a few different options. The first would be the straight surgical handpiece, which is going to feel a little bit foreign to a lot of general practitioners, or something that might be a little bit more familiar in our hands, which would be a 45 degree surgical handpiece. Now, the 45 degree surgical handpieces that you could look at would be, say, a Sabre 45 or an Impact Air 45. Those are both air-driven handpieces, meaning that they do spin at a high speed, but they don't have a lot of torque. And torque is something that I would suggest that you key in on when you're selecting a handpiece. Torque is basically what's going to allow you to section through a tooth or cut bone without having the burr stall out on you. So imagine that you're doing a crown prep and you're using an air-driven handpiece. Sometimes if you get cutting too quickly or leaning too much on that handpiece, the burr is going to stop. And that's because the torque is very low. When you're using an electric handpiece like this or a surgical handpiece that is a straight surgical handpiece, they are going to keep spinning. Now, the only downside to that is that they are going to be generating heat versus stalling out. So the more friction there is, the more pressure there is, the more heat that's generated, meaning that you have to have adequate irrigation throughout this procedure. Now, the irrigant is either going to come from your assistant while you're doing this, or it's going to come from the handpiece in terms of either an external irrigation port, or in the case of this 45 degree handpiece, it actually has a port on it as well that can be adjusted to eliminate the air spray and just use a water jet. Now, my only complaint with using this electric 45 handpiece back here is that it doesn't have a source of isotonic irrigation. Now, I suppose you could set it up that way, but basically when I hook this into my unit, my delivery unit, it's using the delivery unit water. So that is clean water. It's definitely okay to use, but it's not as ideal as it could be if we were using, say, a straight surgical handpiece with an external port, surgical tubing, and then say like some sterile saline, which is osmotically balanced. So that's gonna be kinder to the tissues to use a different type of irrigant than what you're gonna get from these, but they are nice in some situations in terms of access and visibility to the back of the mouth and reaching certain teeth in order to section them. The other thing is they are dual purpose. So if you buy one of these, it's not like you just have to take out third molars with them. You can use them for other procedures in select cases. These high torque surgical handpieces that I'm discussing here are going to be cutting 50% more efficiently than, say, air-driven handpieces. Now, that is very important because research actually shows that the faster you do these procedures, without being reckless, of course, the less post-op pain the patient's going to experience and the less swelling they're going to experience. So you want something that's going to get the job done very quickly and very cleanly, and what you need for that is a high-speed, high-torque handpiece. How fast? Well, you want it spinning at least 80,000 RPMs, could be up to 120,000 RPMs in the straight handpiece. And basically what you're going to find with them is when you get a straight handpiece, say you buy your external motor or you have a delivery unit that's got an electric attachment, you want a straight handpiece that has a 1-2 increaser. So that basically means that it's going to take your max of 40,000 RPMs, which is what a lot of these delivery units have, and it's going to double that into 80,000 RPMs. Now you can also buy 1-3 increasers for these straight surgical handpieces in select brands, and that's then going to take your 40,000 and it's going to triple it into 120,000 RPMs. So the faster it's spinning, again, the quicker it's going to cut, especially if it's a high torque handpiece like I was just discussing. Now straight handpieces are nice because they do accommodate longer burrs. So if we take a peek at this burr here, that is what is sliding into that surgical handpiece. The length of that shank actually allows the burr to spin more concentrically, so you get less vibration, less chatter when you're cutting around these teeth, which is a smoother, nicer experience for your patients, especially if they're still somewhat awake, so they're maybe just slightly sedated, or some people even would do this just with anesthetic depending on what type of patient they are. Getting back to heat generation for a moment, sometimes the flutes on these burrs will get clogged with bone as you're troughing around the tooth. Now it's important to stop every once in a while just to swipe off the flutes, get them cleaned off with your finger or a gauze, in order to allow this to keep spinning and cutting efficiently and cleanly around the tooth. If it's clogged up and it's cutting inefficiently, what's happening then is it's generating friction, generating heat, which is then going to damage some of the bone cells, which then increase the postoperative pain that the patient feels, and it will hinder or impair the healing slightly through the postoperative phase. So we've got our handpiece figured out. Now, what was that burr that I was just showing you? Well, this is a burr that I like to use. This is a 1703L burr. Now, the nice thing about this burr is that it has the ability to give you a bit of a depth gauge or a bit of a reference as to where you're cutting through the tooth or how deep you're sectioning. So the length of the flutes on this burr are actually about 7.8 millimeters long. Now the nice part about that is that the average clinical crown height of a mandibular molar is about 7.5 millimeters. So you know that once you've sunk your flutes into that tooth, you're just about through the clinical crown of that tooth. Now the other thing is that the average buccolingual width of a mandibular molar is about 9 millimeters to 10.5 millimeters. So look what happens when I lay this across this tooth. So this is just your average size tooth. I'm not all the way through the lingual, which is absolutely ideal. So you always want to cut about 2/3 of the way through these teeth, and then you want to split them with your elevator. So again, using these flutes as a depth gauge, you can sink this into the buccal of the tooth, swipe upwards towards the occlusal, and as you're doing that, you can watch how deep you are in the tooth and make sure that you're not puncturing through the lingual aspect of that bone. Now, in contrast to this, you could have a 703 burr or 702 burr, which I have in here now. The flutes on this are only about 4.8 millimeters in length, so that is not really something that's going to help you out too much. You're going to know that you're not through the tooth when you're cutting with this, but how much farther you have left to go is tough to say. So it's something where this is often a little more ideal, but again, designed for the straight surgical handpiece, so something that you'll have to consider maybe switching to if you want to have that luxury. Now, the diameter of the tip here is about 2.1 millimeters, which again is nice because it gives you a nice width for that trough when you actually make it around the tooth. So it gives you just enough that you can get an elevator down in there, but not too much as to take away too much of that cortical bone that I was talking about earlier that we're going to be using to fulcrum off of.